Together with Jalen and Jacoby, what is it that we do?
We give the people what they want.
Tonight, the people get what they want. The NBA season debuts, and in the nightcap, the main event of the evening, we have the first of many battles for Los Angeles in the Staples Center. The Clippers and the Lakers go head-to-head. There's a lot that I'm going to be paying attention to in this game. What will you be keying on right after tip-off?
So first and foremost, I'm so very enthusiastic about this NBA season. And now that we've introduced dynamic duos to the fray, you take out the super teams, which now create a level of intrigue across the league that we have not seen in a very long time. Players, fan bases, really feel like their teams have a legitimate chance to do special things this year. These two teams clearly are in that conversation. What I'm going to be looking for is how the Clippers close the game if it's a tight score. Here's what I mean. When you take out the element of super teams, like I said, every team clearly has flaws that can be exploited. These two teams are notwithstanding. Late in games last year, they gave the ball to the sixth man of the year, Lou Williams, and they let him cook with Montrezl Harrell in the pick and roll.
Yep.
That's not how they're going to finish games anymore. So it could be interesting to see how he's able to still be effective when Paul George returns. It's one thing when he's out with his shoulder surgery. It's another thing when Kawhi and Paul are on the floor, how they use Lou. The other thing, defensively, while the Clippers are going to be terrific defensively.
Oh, yeah.
Lou Williams and Patrick Beverley are a short backcourt. So if you're the Lakers, you now go big. And so on their side, I'm looking for their size to be a difference. LeBron James at 6'9". No Kyle Kuzma, out with an injury. Anthony Davis, 6'11". Dwight Howard, JaVale McGee. And then now all of a sudden you can close the game with a Danny Green, who I anticipate is going to knock down some threes tonight. We're going to be talking about him tomorrow. Watch. I guarantee you. Because he's going to be getting open for shots.
That's what I was thinking too.
That dynamic of LeBron James and Anthony Davis, two of the top five players in the league, going against the Clippers, effort and their grit. It's going to be a terrific stage. It's amazing for the NBA, and I'm excited to get it tipped off.
I really want to look at how LeBron James and AD run their different pick and roll packages, because there's one iteration of this when you've also got a center on the floor, whether it's JaVale McGee or Dwight Howard, and they might be in the dunking spot. And then, like you said, you've got Danny Green on the floor. Maybe you don't have a center on the floor. With Danny Green there, LeBron and AD are going to suck a lot of people towards them. They're just like magnets. Like, you've got the two of them running a pick and roll. That's where everyone's head is going to be focused and their feet are going to go. And Danny Green's going to get a lot of wide open corner threes, wide open wing threes based on that. And I think we will be talking about him tomorrow. That's one of the things I wanted to key on. And a lot of that open threes from some of these Lakers shooters are going to be because LeBron James' passing ability, something that Glenn Doc Rivers spoke about. Let's listen to Doc.
He's one of the great passers in the history of the game that people don't talk about it enough. They really don't. I've always likened him. You know, he gets compared to Michael, and I've never agreed with that. I've always said Magic. He's far more Magic than any player that's ever played the game. So I don't see what he's doing different than handling the ball.
Jalen, what do you think?
Well, I think just like me, Doc is wolfing.
Right now. He's letting it grow out a little bit.
Tonight, he's going to have that line touched up.
That was the first thing I was thinking about, too. He's growing it out so he can get it cut right before the big game tonight.
You know what? He and LeBron has another thing in common that we may or may not know. They probably use the same barber because they need the same tricks in order to have their hairline looking crisp.
Moving on to the first game this evening. I think this one on paper was supposed to look a little bit different. It's supposed to be the big debut of Zion Williamson in Toronto while the Raptors get their rings. But this one obviously is going to be without Zion. Jalen, Zion's been hurt in high school. He's been hurt in college. He's been hurt in summer league. He's been hurt in preseason. Now he's hurt in the regular season. How much of a concern is Zion's injury history when you look at the future of him and the Pelicans and the NBA?
You said the season is starting tonight, right?
Mm-hmm.
and you saying a rookie is injured and not going to be able to play in his first game.
Exactly.
The same rookie that was not able to play in summer league.
Yes, played about one quarter.
The same rookie that played 1 year at Duke and dealt with injury concerns.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, this is an issue for Zion moving forward. Because if you just look at his frame, and I've talked about this for so very long, he's 6'7", David Jacoby. The people that weigh more than him, Taco Fall and Boban, they will never be confused with being mobile or agile or jumping high.
And both of those men are absolute giants.
Correct. And so when you're putting that level of pressure on your extremities, it's going to be an issue. And so for him to be getting surgery before he plays his first game on something that could be anticipated an issue going forward, I have concerns for the young fella.
So I want to liken him to like a Joel Embiid. Joel Embiid, we all saw his basketball ability, the tools, the size, the smooth, the touch, the three-point shot. Early on in the league, he didn't play, and he wasn't playing. And we all looked at him like, oh, injury-plagued player, injury-plagued player. They load manage him, doesn't do back-to-backs. And then he kind of worked himself into back last season where he was playing a lot of games. So I would liken that as Joel Embiid was more like a bump in the road than what looks to be like a career-long injury-plagued career. Do you think that Zion Williamson will be more, this is a bump in the road early in his career, or will this be a career of injuries?
So that was an intelligent comparison, and I'm glad you went there because the first three seasons of Joel Embiid's career, he only played about 82 games, however, number one. Number two, Joel Embiid is 7 foot tall. He can dribble, pass, and shoot, including threes. So therefore, he doesn't always have to attack the basket to be effective.
That's
Zion's game. That's what makes him special. So he ain't gonna be able to see a matchup against a big and be like, I'm gonna hit him between the legs and hezzy and pull up off the glass. That's what Joel can do, because he got those requisite skills. Zion Williamson does not possess that. He has a great handle, but ultimately he wants to finish in the restricted area. So that's the differences I see, but I understand the similarities you have. But I also want to point one more thing out to you. The last 2 years when the Sixers made the playoffs, Joel Embiid missed games because he was not healthy. So the issue still becomes one for his team.
And again, I'm not rooting for anything, but I just want Zion Williamson to be healthy because he is such a great, great athlete to watch play basketball. Jalen, Monday Night Football was last night, and I went to sleep at halftime. I'm not even going to lie. This one was not even close. Not even close, but the Patriots defense made a statement. Sam Darnold was seeing ghosts all night long. He was into the Halloween thing, and he threw 4 picks and lost a fumble. This Patriots defense, we've talked about them all year, but they seem to get better and better and better. What did you see from the dominant defense?
David Jacoby, how much do I like pay attention to and admire secondaries?
I knew what you were going to say. When I'm watching the game, I'm like, I'm going to have to listen to Jalen talk about the secondary again, aren't I?
Going into this year, I said that the Patriots had the best secondary in the NFL. And so I'm going to get back to this resources conversation. There will be people saying, look how well Jacoby Brissett is balling. Look how well Jimmy Garoppolo is balling. The problem is if you invest in those guys, they're standing on the sideline holding a clipboard while Tom Brady leads you to a 7-0 record. They invested it in their defense. Their front seven can get after you with different blitzes. Now their secondary can cover and catch the football. See, one of the things that distinguish guys in high school a lot of times between playing wide receiver and playing cornerback or safety, hands. And the joke was that cornerbacks sometimes play like they are wearing boxing gloves. Not the Patriots D-backs. You throw that thing out there for McCourty, you throw that thing out there for Gilmore, they snatching it. And so now all of a sudden, the Patriots have rebuilt their team as a defensive-oriented one that's so very scary. And now you add Mohamed Sanu to the mix, the receiver that they were missing, a healthy version of a Josh Gordon, without all of the personal issues. I love Sanu so much. As an under-radar player, I've drafted him on my fantasy team 3 straight years, including this one.
Good. Well, I'm sure you're glad about that move. Well, those Patriots athletes on defense were all over the field, but it was also the schemes that Belichick had them in. Sam Darnold and Patriot defender discussed exactly what they did with Darnold. Let's listen right now.
When I talk to the coach, I just got to be, you know, straight up. And, you know, for me, I just got to see the field a lot better. That's kind of what that means. And, you know, just it was a rough day out there, rough night out there. And obviously I got to be better and learn from the mistakes. But we will get better.
He said at one point on the ESPN broadcast that I felt like he was seeing those out there.
He did?
Yeah.
Oh, man. That's the boogeyman. It's real.
You talk about the kind of the continuity of your defense where up front you guys are putting
pressure. Sorry. He really said that?
Yeah. Well, how were you guys able to rattle him for
that's,
him to
that's
see?
That's crazy
goes?
For him to say that. It is. That makes it real. You know what I'm saying? That's crazy.
What's that mean to you that he's seeing ghosts?
I mean, I can't believe he said that.
He just seems so proud. Van Noy just seems so proud that he said that. He's like, wait, tell me again what he said. Like, wait, tell me again what he said. Jalen, what do you think of that sound?
First and foremost, Van Noy is a beast. He can cover. He can rush. He's respectfully an animal out there, and I love the way he ball. The problem for Sam Darnold is twofold. Number one, his coach Adam Gase, I appreciate that he has a level of looking himself in the mirror and knowing what his weaknesses are. And you remember his press conference when everybody made fun of his eyes? You notice how low he wears his hat now? He makes sure that you can't see his eye. So the problem with how low he wearing his hat, he clearly couldn't see the field and clearly couldn't pay attention to the fact that they were blitzing so many times that the guy was unblocked almost before he got to Sam Darnold. And so this is a young player, had turnover issues while he was in college. He showed promise against the Cowboys. I'm not going to overreact too heavily either way to how he played against the Cowboys versus how he played against the Patriots.
That's a very fair assessment. Someone who had an extremely unfair assessment of Steph Curry is Michael Jeffrey Jordan. We will show you what he said about Steph right after this.